नमस्ते, माई सेल्फ त्रिवेणी खुराना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, फैकल्टी फिजियोथेरेपी एंड डायग्नोस्टिक्स, JVN, राजस्थान। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट मैनिंजाइटिस। मैनिंजाइटिस, इट इज़ द इन्फ्लेमेशन ऑफ द मैनिंजेस कवरिंग द ब्रेन। इट इज़ अ पैथोलॉजिकल डेफिनेशन। द सेरेब्रो स्पाइनल फ्लूइड टिपिकली एग्जिबिट्स एन एलिवेटेड नंबर ऑफ ल्यूकोसाइट्स। इन एडल्ट्स, more than 5 leukocytes per milliliter is defined as elevated. Bacterial or viral meningitis is confirmed by the detection of a pathogen in the CSF. Bacterial meningitis may also be suggested by symptoms of meningism and appropriate bacteria in the blood. Now, what are the various types of meningitis? We have subacute meningitis, bacterial meningitis, viral meningitis, fungal meningitis, tuberculous meningitis, syphilitic meningitis, parasitic meningitis, and the Lyme meningitis. Now, what are the causes of meningitis? The most common causes of meningitis in immunocompetent adult are viruses and bacteria. Viruses account for up to half of cases. Enterovirus is the commonest, with herpes simplex and varicella zoster the next most frequent. Streptococcus pneumoniae and Neisseria meningitis are the common bacteria, together accounting for approximately 1/4 of cases. Other causes such as Haemophilus influenza, Listeria monocytogenes, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and fungi, typically cryptococci, are less frequently detected, together representing less than 10% of cases. Currently, many adults with meningitis have no pathogen detected, although Listeria and tuberculosis are the more common causes, that is viral and the bacterial meningitis. Now, what are the clinical features of meningitis? Clinical feature alone cannot confirm the diagnosis of meningitis. A lumbar puncture is essential to confirm the diagnosis of meningitis and establish the cause. In one study, 95% of bacterial meningitis patients had at least two symptoms of headache, neck stiffness, fever, and altered consciousness. The latter three features were present together in only 44% of cases. Neurological deficits are found in around 1/3 of patients. Similar findings are reported by other studies. Rash and suspected meningitis makes and meningitis more likely. However, 37% of meningococcal meningitis patients have no rash. Varicella and enterovirus can also be associated with rash. Risk factors for Listeria meningitis include overt or relative immune compromise, the latter including chronic illness, diabetes, alcohol dependency, malignancy, or old age. Listeria meningitis is rarely seen in immunocompetent adults under 60 years of age. Travel history, symptoms of otitis media, sinusitis, contact with another person with meningitis, sepsis or tuberculosis are other useful diagnostic clues. Now, what is lumbar puncture? It is an investigatory method for diagnosing meningitis. Lumbar puncture is the key investigation. It enables rapid confirmation of meningitis and type of infecting organism. Diagnostic yield of LP can be diminished by collecting small CSF volumes. At least 10 ml can be safely removed. Next investigation is by cerebrospinal fluid cell count. CSF remains one of the most rapidly informative tests. Leukocytosis indicates meningeal inflammation, of which infection is the most common cause. Van de Beek and colleagues reported that more than 90% of adults with bacterial meningitis had a CSF leukocyte count more than 100 cells per microliter. Absence of leukocytosis makes meningitis much less likely, but does not completely rule it out. Approximately 1-2% of patients with bacterial meningitis will have a normal CSF leukocyte count. Positive pathogen detection and an absence of leukocytosis more frequently occurs among children. The immunocompromised, those pre-treated with antibiotics or with Mycobacterium tuberculosis infections. CSF leukocyte differential can help predict which type of pathogen is causing infection. Lymphocyte predominance suggests viral, while neutrophil predominance suggests bacterial infection. There are several exceptions to this general guide, including CSF neutrophil predominance observed in association with tuberculosis meningitis. CSF glucose is normally approximately 2/3 the blood plasma concentration. It is often lower in bacterial and tuberculosis meningitis. As CSF glucose is influenced by plasma glucose, it is essential to measure blood glucose at lumbar puncture to obtain an accurate CSF blood glucose ratio. A CSF blood glucose ratio, it is less than 0.36, is an accurate, that is 93% marker for distinguishing bacterial from the viral meningitis. CSF protein is normally less than 0.4 gram per liter. Elevated protein suggests inflammation. A CSF protein less than 0.6 gram per liter largely rules out bacterial infection. CSF parameters have been combined into tools to help diagnose bacterial meningitis. One prediction rule accurately distinguished bacterial from the viral meningitis in two adult patient population using retrospective data. Clinical prediction tools have also exhibited high accuracy when tested retrospectively in large child population. Now, CSF microscopy with Gram strain. CSF fluid microscopy with Gram strain can rapidly detect bacteria. It has a sensitivity between 50% and 99%. Detection, particularly for M. tuberculosis, is enhanced by a collection of more than 10 ml of CSF and subsequent cytospin. Now, the CSF culture. CSF culture is historically regarded as the gold standard for the diagnosis of bacterial meningitis. It is diagnostic in 70 to 85% of cases prior to antibiotic exposure. Sensitivity decreases by 20% following antibiotic pretreatment. CSF sterilization can occur within 2 to 4 hours of antibiotic administration for meningococci and pneumococci respectively. Lumbar puncture should be performed as soon as possible to maximize pathogen detection. Now, the CSF polymerase chain reaction. CSF polymerase chain reaction using pathogen-specific nucleic acid sequences can detect both bacteria and viruses with high sensitivity. Polymerase chain reaction is the gold standard for diagnosis of viral meningitis. Polymerase chain reaction is increasingly relied upon in bacterial meningitis. It has far greater sensitivity than cultural in invasive meningococcal disease. CSF fluid PCR is particularly valuable in patients who receive antibiotics before lumbar puncture. Polymerase chain reactions for 16S ribosomal RNA that present in almost all bacteria, which enables a broad screen for bacteria but has lower sensitivity than pathogen-specific PCR. Other investigations are blood test. Blood cultures should always be taken on admission and are helpful when antibiotics are started before lumbar puncture. Blood cultures are positive in 50 to 80% of bacterial meningitis cases. Blood PCR substantially increases the confirmation in meningococcal disease. Despite these tests, many patients will not have a cause identified for their meningitis. Blood biomarkers such as procalcitonin and C-reactive protein can help distinguish bacterial from viral meningitis in adults and can be used to help guide treatment if no etiology is found. Host biomarkers for detecting bacterial meningitis are being actively investigated by our group. Now the swabs, throat, nasopharyngeal and stool swabs are useful for detecting enteroviruses if the CSF-PCR is negative. Next, detection is by brain imaging. Brain imaging is neither obligatory in the management of meningitis nor a prerequisite to lumbar puncture. Performing neuroimaging before lumbar puncture is associated with delays in commencing antibiotics, which in turn can lead to an increase in mortality. An urgent CT scan should be performed if there are clinical signs of brain shift. Clinical features indicative of a brain shift include focal neurological signs and reduced Glasgow coma score. A 2016 UK meningitis guidelines recommended and lumbar puncture be performed without prior neuroimaging if the GCS is more than 12. Patients with a GCS less than 12 should be considered for critical care, intubation assessment and neuroimaging, particularly when contrast is used, may exhibit meningeal enhancement in meningitis. When brain shift is identified, liaison between critical care and neurosurgical team are essential. Now there are some indications for brain imaging before lumbar puncture in suspected meningitis. These are focal neurological signs, presence of papillodemia, and continuous or uncontrolled seizures. To exclude significant brain swelling or shift that may predispose to cerebral herniation post lumbar puncture, inability to view the fundus is not a contraindication to lumbar puncture, especially in patients who have had a short duration of symptoms. Lumbar puncture without prior neuroimaging may be safe at the levels below GCS. Initial assessment is used. Now the management. Management is started with the history taking. Infants with meningitis frequently present with the non-specific symptoms such as fever, irritability, lethargy, poor feeding, vomiting and diarrhea. Older children may complain of headache or photophobia. Seizures may be present. Now the features on examinations are: an infant, anterior frontal will usually be full and may be bulging. Neck stiffness may or may not be present. A purpuric rash is suggestive of meningococcal septicemia. Cunning signs, it is a hip flexion with an extended knee that causes pain in the back and leg. Next, CSF shunt, spinal and cranial abnormalities which may have predisposed a child to meningitis. Signs of encephalitis are altered consciousness state, focal neurological signs, and infants may have a high-pitched cry. Now, admission assessment. Assess and record baseline vital signs that are heart rate, BP, respiratory rate, oxygen saturation, temperature and pain. Neurological assessment include level of consciousness using AVPU or modified GCS and seizure activity. Assess fontanelle for fulling and bulging. Renal assessment for assessing and recording hydration status. Skin assessment for inspection of skin for rash. Non-blanching petechial purpuric rash is indicative of acute meningococcal disease. Now, management includes treat seizures in the setting of meningitis immediately. Fluid resuscitation may be required in ICU. Antibiotics must not be delayed for more than 30 minutes once the decision to treat has been made. A delay to antibiotics associated with poorer outcomes. Thank you.